Baroni too. That
was my.
Good to be alive in this land of ours. Good to drive in this land of ours.
Hello, Canada hockey fans in the United States. If it's 7 o'clock Eastern time on a Thursday night, it's Hockey Time Machine. Good evening, everybody. I'm Steve Paikin. Delighted on behalf of Paul and Laura and Glenn to welcome everybody to our Thursday night program. And this one is very timely, of course, February being Black History Month. It's very appropriate that we shine the spotlight on one of the most consequential players in NHL history, not so much because he scored a lot of goals, because he didn't score a lot of goals, but because of the fact that he took the ice at all. That made him a pioneer for opening up a game that for so many decades had been restricted to so few. So, to talk about the singular contribution of Willie O'Ree to the game of hockey, let's welcome, in Boston, Massachusetts, Brian McBride. He was vice president of business development for the National Hockey League from 1991 to 2000. Bryant created what is now called the Hockey is for Everyone program in 1993, and he hired Willie O'Ree as the NHL ambassador in 1994. In Montreal, Quebec, Laurence Mathieu Léger, she directed the 2019 documentary called Willie, which was an official selection of the Hot Docs Film Festival in Toronto. The film was produced by Bryant McBride. And in Cabo, Baja California, Mexico, Jay Shearers, he's officiated in 1,565 regular season NHL games, 204 playoff games, 7 Stanley Cups, 1 All-Star game, and let's not forget the 2010 Olympics. Welcome, everybody. I see Laurence had a little trouble dialing up, so we're going to try to get her back in as well. But there are a lot of people. There she is. Bonsoir, Laurence. Comment allez-vous?
Hi, sorry, everything crashed for some reason, but hello.
Well, you make movies, so you know how fickle technology can be.
Right,
there we go.
It was on my end, but I'm glad it was, because it looks like all of you guys are here, so perfect.
Perfect. Well, there are a lot more people today who know who Willie O'Ree was and is, and the contributions he made to hockey, thanks to the three of you. And I want to start with the documentary that Laurence, you and Bryant did a few years ago. So, Glenn, if you would, let's roll our first clip.
When I was 14, I had set 2 goals for myself, play pro hockey and play in the National Hockey League.
And Boston with O'Ree down the ice, up over the leaf.
It never dawned on me that I broke down barriers and opened doors for players of color that are now playing in the National Hockey League.
Willie O'Ree of the Boston Bruins, a native of Fredericton, New Brunswick, is the first Negro to play in the National Hockey League.
And there he is. We were at that game. He's inspired a generation of hockey players.
Now, Laurence, I want to start with you. You're known as a filmmaker who focuses on hockey. And I want to know how the story of Willie O'Ree first came to you.
Well, that's an interesting story. Brian McBride actually used to be my neighbor in Harlem, in New York City. We had known each other for a few years and would always interact in some capacity. And one day I kind of ran into him one evening, and he was kind of sitting on the stoop. And he's the one who actually told me about Willie O'Ree. At the time, he was talking about the possibility of Willie being inducted into Hockey Hall of Fame, but it hadn't happened. And immediately I thought to myself two things. Why do I not know who Willie O'Ree is? I grew up in Montreal, which is a hockey city, and we grow up watching hockey. And then I thought to myself, why has no one made a movie about this? And so Brian and I started talking about the possibility of maybe working together on telling the story, and the rest is history.
The rest indeed is history. Brian, I should ask you then, how did you first hear about Willie O'Ree's story?
When I was 10 years old in Sault Ste. Marie, when I was a hockey player, and I wanted to be the first black player in the NHL. So I went to the library, and there he was. And I was a little upset with him between the age of 10 and 12, but I got over it. And I just knew who he was growing up, but I'd really not thought about it a lot. And I was working at the league, and Laurence and everyone's friend, Lou Vero, if you guys know Lou, for those of you that don't, you should, he's an incredible guy. Lou suggested, he said, hey, you know what, we should call Willie. We were setting up the diversity task force that you mentioned earlier, with USA Hockey and the NHL as partners on it. And Lou said, we should call Willie O'Ree. And I was like, oh my God, you're right, we should. And I did. I went out and I found him, tried to find him first. So we found him through, and there's no Google. This was a long time ago. And I got on a plane and I went, I asked a friend from the FBI who's a big hockey fan, black FBI agent. And he said, oh yeah, I remember Willie O'Ree. And he helped me find him. And I went out and I saw him. And it was just, when I met Willie for the first time, he's exactly the same as he is now. I mean, gracious, earnest, humble, just an incredible guy, for those of you that have met him and seen him on TV and in the media. So that's how it all came together. And then to fast forward to the stoop, sitting at my place in Harlem on the stairs, Laurence is walking by and, told her the story. But, Laurence was the one who said, we have to make this movie. And it, like a life, I was like, you know what, you're right, we do. And we did.
Okay, Jay, let's get you on the record. When did you first become aware of the Willie O'Ree story?
So I knew a little bit about Willie when I was a kid, but didn't really do the research that I probably should have. But then when I had the pleasure of meeting him back in 99, 98, 2000, I took a greater interest, or took, a greater appreciation for what he had been through and what he had done. And no different from my story as being the first black official in the NHL, I realized just what an accomplishment that was for him.
Well, let's go back and look at some really wonderful old footage that we have. This is January 18th, 1958, which was Willie's first game in the NHL. And okay, Glenn, let's see Willie doing his thing. The clip.
North Boston at his own blue line, a pass to O'Ree on the right side. It's a chance for Smith of Boston, a shot. Matty Eagle made the save, another try, they've made it, score! O'Ree was looked to be the last one to touch it, and it's 3-1.
Well, that's actually not his first game, because the first game was in Montreal, where Laurence is right now, but I think that's his first goal. And I want to get a sense from each of you about the significance of the moment that I suggested a moment ago. January 18th, 58, Laurence, a black man, plays hockey in the highest league in the world for the first time ever. In your view, what was the significance of that moment?
Well, first of all, as you guys know, black people had been playing hockey for many, many years prior to Willie taking the ice. There's so many things we can say about the significance of this, but the sole fact that he was able to skate that night was the accomplishment, right? I mean, it was breaking that barrier. And I don't know, and Willie often says that all he wanted to do was play, and that's all he cared about. It wasn't so much about being the first black person to play in a National Hockey League game. But I think it sent a message that it was time for things to change. It took 20 years for another black player to take the ice in the NHL, so it was an instant. But that was quite an accomplishment, knowing what he had to push through to get there in the first place. And so when I think about it today and why we're celebrating, and thankfully we're celebrating him while he's still alive, for me, that's amazing. It's a celebration of courage. It's a celebration of never giving up, and that anything is possible. And that's why it was an important moment.
Bryant, what was the significance of that moment in your judgment?
There's just so much wrapped into it. I mean, you look at the larger, the macro environment at that time. I mean, it was at the really at the beginnings of the civil rights movement in the United States and Canada, but mostly in the United States. And I mean, it was a difficult time, right? In that people were really starting, black people and marginalized people were really starting to assert themselves and say, you know what, this what's going on isn't right. It's not fair. So for Willie to do it at that time period was significant. But what was also interesting, Lawrence and I, when we first started shooting the film, we spent a lot of time in Fredericton. That was our first stop, and that was really eye-opening in a lot of ways in Fredericton. And that just the love and the care and that community loves Willie O'Ree. Like very few. Every town has their heroes and you know favorite sons, but the love for Willie there is just it just felt so deep and so different, right? They were just so proud of everything that he did. And I think largely because the O'Ree family was so loved in Fredericton. They were, you know, they were one of two black families in town. So, you know, so everyone knew them, but just the dignified kind of aura around the family, Willie's mom and dad. And, you know, he was the youngest of 13. So there were O'Ree kids everywhere, all over the town. And they just, they were just so respected in the town. The people just really wanted them, you know, first black player or not, everyone was pulling for Willie to do well and to make it because he was just so, so loved and so cherished in that town. And, you know, our takeaway from that, my takeaway, at least, I think Lawrence as well, but I won't speak for her, but was that, you know, when a town rallies around all of their young people, you know, incredible things can happen. And that's what Fredericton did. I'm sure he faced lots of things when he was there. I know he did. And in other places. But that town wanted Willie to succeed, you know, in the worst way. So it felt as though the whole town was willing him, to me at least, onto the ice. And that was really expressed well in the film and just privately over many years by one of Willie's best friends, Junior Doherty. Who just embodies that and epitomizes the love for Willie in that town. So it felt like the accomplishment of a small Canadian town, right? As much as it was breaking the color barrier, which is an angle that that just not a lot of people think about, but just the pride was immense when he made it.
Jay, I wonder if I can get you to follow up on something Laurence just said, which is, this didn't exactly change everything instantly, right? It did not herald the beginning of more black players in the NHL for a very long time. Right. And I wonder whether we have to keep that in mind in as much as the moment didn't change everything right away, right?
No, and I think, as you guys know, sometimes change happens slowly. And I think you look at the league now and you look at society now, there's just such a better understanding of people of color, maybe transcending barriers and being involved in sports or being involved in businesses that typically people always thought were for people who were Caucasian. So I think, you know, to pick up on what Brian said, like my parents met in 1958, a black man from Jamaica, a white woman from Canada. And again, like Brian said, being that at the almost, you know, the pinnacle of civil rights and knowing what my parents faced and what they had to go through, I think that's why for me, Willie's story is even more special because I lived that or, you know, grew to understand what my parents went through.
Well, one of the things that certainly surprised me is to learn how apparently welcoming the Bruins were as a team to Willie's playing on that roster. And we have Willie talking about that, so let's play that clip. Glenn, can we hear that clip, please, now?
I will never forget how my teammates in the Bruins locker room accepted me as one of their own. This was a time when some of the fans and opposing players were not ready to see a black man in the NHL. When I became the first, I remembered the advice my older brother Richard gave me. He said he was not only my brother and my friend, but my mentor. He used to say, Willie, focus on your goals you set for yourself, work hard, and stay positive. This is what I try to do as a member of the Bruins every time I put on the jersey.
Brian, I want to put this next question to you because you're in Boston and you're the last person in the world I have to tell that the Red Sox were the last team in Major League Baseball to integrate. Boston as many people know, has had its issues with discrimination and racism over the years. So I'm curious as to how surprised you were to hear that Willie apparently received a pretty decent welcome when he played for the Bruins.
Yeah, I mean, on one side, I wasn't that surprised in that, and I've learned more since. You know, it's a hockey team, right? And, you know, if somebody's wearing your jersey, you know, they're with you. So it would, you know, it was not surprising in that regard. But yeah, Boston has had its issues, obviously, over a long period of time. Some of the background that we learned and some of the conversations we had really filled in some holes. When he was alive and rest in peace, you know, Milt Schmidt was key in that whole scenario, as was, I think it was Lynn Patrick. Yeah, as was Lynn Patrick, right? They called him up and they were going to make sure that he fit in and that he got his opportunity and he got his chance. But I think one of the main, and so they were super helpful. And if anyone who met Milt Schmidt, I mean, he was just an incredible, incredible gentleman. And Willie liked to say about Milt, he loved him. They loved each other. And, you know, they just had so much respect for each other. Willie said he never heard him swear. And I think he may be the only NHL coach ever to never swear, you know, NHL coaches, right? So that was interesting. But the other person that played such a key role in that, and Lawrence and I interviewed him, he was only in a little bit of the film, was Johnny Busick. Johnny Busick took Willie under his wing. I mean, he said, you know, no, I got this guy. I'm going to make sure that he, you know, Johnny was the leader on the team and really respected by everyone. And he made sure that Willie got, you know, the welcome mat. And it was hard. I mean, there were, you know, games in Chicago and other places where police escorts, and I mean, it got pretty crazy at times for Willie, but Johnny and Milt and, you know, just the whole Bruins organization, they treated him, you know, with great respect and dignity, and they weren't going to let anything happen to him.
Laurence, one of the things we learned in your documentary is that not only did Willie make history when he stepped on the ice that night in 1958, but he did it blind in one eye. How did he manage to play in the NHL blind in one eye?
Every time I think about that, I find that so inspiring. Just seeing Willie on your show made me like almost tear up. I think he had a lot of will, and he didn't let anything get in his way. What we learned while we were in Fredericton from some of the local historians is that Willie had been a legend in the Maritimes before his eye injury. He was like the best player of all times. And after his injury, people thought it's the end. He's never going to come back. And because Willie was driven and he wouldn't let anything get in his way, he came back and proved them wrong. And so the fact that despite that injury, he was able to get to the NHL as the first Black person and likely one of the first disabled person is just a testament to who he is. And is also sending a message that anything is possible, and it's extremely inspiring. And I remembered when we premiered at Hot Docs, we had a variety of people coming up to me. That's a terrible picture, please don't show me.
Now, what don't you like about that picture?
Laurence, there are no terrible pictures anymore.
I am like really about to explode. but anyways, I think I remember specifically a young man coming up to me saying, I have autism, and to know that Willie had a disability gives me a lot of strength and courage and makes me feel like I, you know, have someone to look up to. So beyond the question of race and being the first Black person to break the color barrier, he was also sending a message that if you have a disability, nothing is impossible and you can make your dreams possible. So that is, you know, beyond everything that Willie's accomplished, it's really something that inspires me immensely.
I want to add one quick thing.
Please,
to that,
Brian.
What Laurence said, I think it's, we asked a hockey historian in Fredericton who, Ernie Fitzsimmons, I think Ernie Fitzsimmons, yeah, Lawrence, right? Yeah. He's just a brilliant guy. And he was the AHL league photographer. So he saw every game, took a picture literally of every guy who played in the AHL for 50 years. I mean, it's just, he's an amazing guy, encyclopedic. The Hockey Hall of Fame calls him when they're not sure of something. He's that kind of guy, right? And we asked Willie, Lawrence and I interviewed him in his house. We asked him, we asked Ernie, how many goals would he have played if he didn't hurt if his eye, if he didn't, you know, lose his eye. And he was that, and he, without it, hesitating, 40 to 50 goal scorer in the 16 NHL. He goes, no doubt. He was that fast. Johnny Busick added to that by saying, you know, we called him the king of the near miss because, you know, they didn't know he had one eye. They weren't, you know, he really didn't tell anyone. But when he got in close, you know, he'd be flying, and he was moving. He was just so much, he was fast, right? But when he get in close, his depth perception wasn't, you know, what it needed to be, and he couldn't finish. So that's why he didn't stick. But if he would have not lost his eye, there were people who were sure that he was a perennial all-star.
Well, we did see one picture of Laurence a moment ago, looking un petit peu enceinte, I think. And Laurence, I know this is a hockey show, but I'm going to call an audible here, which is a football term. Glenn, do we have any other pictures of Laurence? Oh, yes, we do. Laurence, you seem to want to have your children with you wherever you go. What's going on in that shot there?
Listen, I just think, kind of like Willie, you don't see a lot of mothers in production, and you don't see a lot of mothers being asked to direct sports movies at all, or women at all. And I've gotten to a point in my life where I don't ask permission and I just show up, and I have three kids, and all of my kids have been with me on some kind of a set for some big production, including this middle daughter who basically was with me in Fredericton the whole time. So I think that's part of representing. And if anyone taught me well to represent is Willie and the wonderful people who are in my dock, and that's what I try to do. I want to keep doing what I do. It's part of my DNA, and I'm a better parent for it. And that's it.
That is a beautiful picture. That is a wonderful picture. A wonderful picture.
You know, I should also say, sure, that, you know, this was a really small crew and effort. You know, small crew made a huge effort, of which most of the crew, this was a women made film, women made minority made film. Laurence at the helm, Rosella Tursi, our lead editor, Ebian Behe, who's our associate producer, and me. And then some really, really great women freelancers. I mean, I think the eye that Laurence brought to it and the just the lens that to make this movie so that it made it much more than a sports movie. It really did. And that's just, you know, I don't think enough people know that. It needs to be known that there were some just brilliant women behind the camera and behind the scenes making this film.
Well, one of the moments they captured for posterity was the phone call that came into Willie O'Ree's home to let him know that he was, in fact, going to become a member of the Hockey Hall of Fame. Glenn, let's have a look at that moment if we can.
There are so many reasons to celebrate Willie's life and accomplishments.
Willie is a hero. He's a hockey hero.
If he's not a builder, then I don't know who is, you know.
There are few players worthier of being inducted into the Hall of Fame, and it is long overdue that Willie's name be added to that list.
Being in the Hall of Fame, I don't think there's any higher title that you'd want to receive.
Toronto.
Willie, it's Willie McDonald and John Davidson with the Hockey Hall of Fame.
Oh, God.
Oh, you get chills just watching that. Laurence, I assume you were there in
the trailer we cut. I don't think that's nice to see it again, but that interview with it's really nice to see this footage. Thank you.
I almost cry every time I see it, Laurence. I really do. I do. I still get really emotional.
Laurence, were you in the home when that call came in?
Oh, absolutely. I was in a home with Brian. We actually thought the call wasn't coming in because it took. There's a bit of a, for those people who've seen the film, it just like goes on and on. Like sometimes in documentary and in film in general, you want to build sort of tension or a moment that's like, you know, to carry the audience through it. But this was real. Like we actually waited for the call. And at some point we were like, oh, maybe he's not going to get the call. And so Brian and I were just like sitting in the kitchen texting each other. We're like, is he getting the call?
Oh,
and
my God.
I'm not sure. And did anyone else get a call? Like, I don't know. And so when he got the call, it was genuine and emotional. And I think, you know, we don't see it in a film, but like Willie came over to give me a hug and he cheered me with some champagne. I was holding the camera. So it was just a privilege to be there with him, to celebrate that with him and his family and Bryant. It's a beautiful moment that I cherish.
Jay, if you are black and you love hockey, how important is that moment to you?
Oh, I mean, it's iconic. I mean, even for being in Boston a few weeks ago when Willie's jersey was retired and, you know, we were talking about it, and it's just like, it's such a pivotal moment in the history of the National Hockey League. So, and I think, you know, Brian spoke to it before, Willie's character and just who he is as a person transcends the fact that he was the first black player in the NHL. I mean, he's just an incredible person. And I think the fact that other people now get to hear his story and understand what he went through in the game of hockey and inspire young men and women to want to play the game that they may have always thought was typically for people, for people who are Caucasian, I think it's just such a great story. And it just, it's, I think we need more positive stories in today's world, as I'm sure all of you will agree. And I think Willie's story is just, it's just a wonderful story.
Bryant, why was there any confusion at all about whether or not he was going to make it into the Hall?
Well, it was first, this really started on the 60th, 4 years ago, on the 60th anniversary of Willie's first game. Willie invited me, and I went to the Boston Garden and with my family, and we were enjoying the game, and it just like struck me. And Kim Davis was the first night I ever met Kim Davis, and Gary Bettman was in the box, and I just sat down next to Gary. We're catching up, and I said, "Listen, why isn't Willie in the Hall? What are we doing? Like, this is crazy." And he was like, "Well, you know, I can't influence the Hall." You know, I said, "Of course," but I said, "Like, let's go." And I said, "I'm going to start working at this, Gary. You know, and he was like, "Absolutely. Anything I can do to help, let me know, you know, call John Davidson, call Lanny." And I did. And you know, you don't lobby to get into the Hall of Fame. It's just not what you do. So quietly, we met, and luckily we met a wonderful couple that's in the film, David and Brenda Sansom. And they were working in concert in parallel with us in Fredericton, doing a fan submitted bid, nomination, and it just, the work that David and Brenda and the whole city of Fredericton put in was just, it was unreal. So we just joined our efforts, and then in about a quarter of the way in, Laurence and I sat down and put our heads together towards the film. So, you know, all of this momentum was building, and I felt really strongly that as a build, and we had to research it, we had to figure it out. He wasn't getting in as a player, right? He played 45 games, and that, you know, that they're not going to change the rules or bend the rules for the, regardless of if he broke a barrier. And I don't think Willie would want to get in that way. So we looked at the rules, we looked at the structure, and we said, he's a builder. This is what he's been doing for his whole life. Willie, you know, and he's had that official capacity at the NHL for 20 some years, 26, 27 years. But Willie was doing this when he was 18. He was signing every autograph, encouraging all kids, kids of color especially, to play. And, you know, hey, if I can do it, you can do it too, you know, kind of attitude. So, you know, he's been a builder his whole life. I mean, literally, he's 86 now. So he's been doing it for years and years. So we felt pretty strongly he was going to get in. We, you know, every indication was he would get in that builder category. And then when it just, the phone wouldn't ring, you know, and they were, I think they were going through, we have a good sense, they were going through other nominations, and that was taking longer because I've heard through the grapevine, and I won't say who, but that Willie was unanimous, and it was decided in 20 minutes, but he was first, and then we just had to wait for, you know, 20 for 4 other hours and 20 other discussions to take place. And that's when they finished, that's when they called. So, you know, seeing John Davidson and Lanny's number pop up was just like, oh, thank goodness. Laurence and I were really worried. I mean, we were sweating it out, but it worked out. It worked out.
It did. Laurence, I know you have to leave us now, so let me ask you just one last question, and that is, based on what you learned doing your documentary on Willie, do you think black kids now feel that they have a place in this game in a way that maybe they didn't 6 decades ago?
I mean, I want to speak for anyone who's marginalized. Black, brown, Asian, Native American women in general. And I think there's still a lot of work to do. We've seen it on the news recently with what happened with the Subban brothers. We see it constantly in different other sports. Luckily, we have social media. We have other means to talk about discrimination and what's not right. And also, luckily, things are changing and attitudes are changing and I think are evolving as societies. But I think we shouldn't just like sit back and be proud of ourselves that we've gotten to this point. Like there's enormous work to do and we have to, I think ideally the future should be like, we shouldn't be thinking about that anymore. It shouldn't be a sport, a white sport with minorities in it or a men's sport with women in it. It should just be hockey. I think we just need to continue doing this important work of sharing stories, telling our stories, having empathy, trying to put ourselves in other people's shoes and just keep working at it the best we can. And, when I think about Willie, he's an extraordinary example. And what happened a few weeks ago when his jersey was retired was not about the statistics. It was not about being the best player of all time. It was about breaking an important barrier. And when I think about that, I just find that extremely inspiring, thinking that we're finally celebrating someone who did something that was thought to be impossible and change history. And so I think it's all about the work ahead.
Well said. Laurence, thank you so much for joining us tonight from Montreal. We're grateful.
Jay, it was nice to be on a call with you too. And bye, Brian. Yes.
Nice to be on a call with you too.
Very well said. Very well said.
Bye, guys.
Now, I'm not finished with Brian and Jay yet. You two can't go anywhere yet. Because I do want to go back to a night that transpired not too long ago. It was last month at the new Boston Garden, whatever they call that now, the TD Garden. And the Bruins retired Willie's number 22, 64 years after his Bruins debut. Let's have a look at some of that footage. Glenn, if you would. Jay, I just want to start with you and ask, what's going through your head as you're watching that footage?
Oh, I mean, you know, Brian said it earlier, you almost get emotional. I mean, I was so fortunate that I was able to be there live to witness Anson Carter and the other members raising the banner. And it was raising the banner celebrating his retirement. And it was just, And I think I may be repeating myself. It's something that probably for me will even take some more time to sink in, just what a moment that was and just what Willie has contributed as a builder, as a person in the game of hockey and inspiring and motivating and having people see him as a mentor. I just feel so blessed that I was there that night to actually witness it in person. And I must say the Bruins organization did a fantastic job. And in terms of the ceremony, in terms of the in-between periods, video montages that were going on, I think it was a tremendous celebration of just who Willie is and what his jersey retirement represented to the game of hockey.
Bryant, you were there that night too. What did it mean to you?
Yeah, I'll go echo what Jay said, and then he said it was almost emotional. It was emotional. I was crying my eyes out. For me, it was so personal, you know. I mean, this the long relationship I had with Willie and that I have with Willie, and that night was, you know, it was 25 years of pushing the boulder uphill, you know, and that's just a small piece of time that Willie had to do it, you know, and so it was super emotional. It was, I echo what Jay said, it was brilliant. The Bruins did a really great job of, you know, in a tough situation during COVID and, you know, Willie couldn't be there, unfortunately, because of COVID. So that made it you know, a little tougher. But they did a bang up job. It was amazing. It was great to see all of the people. There were people crying everywhere in the stands. So I was looking around, and it was just so emotional and so special to be there for that. That same thing, I'll cherish that for the rest of my life, watching that number 22 go up. What I really want, I'm really excited about, and I'm going to make sure when Willie comes back to Boston, I am going to figure out how to be with him when he walks in for the first time and looks up. That's going to be cool.
And sees his 22 in the rafters.
Yeah, that's going to be cool.
He said he got number 22.
Jay, I'll make sure that we plan it. That's that's going to be special.
He said there was nothing special about his wearing number 22. That's just the number they gave him, but that he was 22 years old when he stepped on the ice for the Bruins. So that's a nice connection. I want to ask a bit of a, I guess this is a bit of a chippy question, but here we go. You know, I used to live in Boston, and I've gone to a lot of games at Fenway Park and a few games at the old Boston Garden and the new TD Garden. The crowds are overwhelmingly white, overwhelmingly. And some days at Fenway Park, you know, you can look all over, it'd be 37,000 people there, and you wouldn't see a black face in the stands. I wonder, Jay, what your thoughts are about all of these white people standing and giving a standing ovation to a black man in Boston.
Yeah, well, here's a little backstory. My first regular season game and my first playoff game were both in Boston. So Boston holds certainly a place in my heart, in my career. I think that, you know, to Brian's point before, I think people just, the sports brings people together. And I think sports can always transcend race, discrimination. And I think that's the thing about that. But I know for me, when I worked my first game in Boston, it was intimidating. But I'd been through that in, you know, cities in the Western Hockey League, in Western Canada and Western United States. So I didn't really think too much about it. I've probably thought more about my journey, or even a person like Willie's journey, more so in retirement than I did when I was on the ice. Because when I was on the ice, I just wanted to be the best official in the National Hockey League. I wasn't necessarily focused on the fact of maybe what I represented in terms of my accomplishment. And now in retirement, and now in the new role that I have with the National Hockey League, I definitely take that a lot more seriously and realize that I can be somebody that someone can look up to. So I think that's the bigger thing for me, is being able to give back to a game that gave me so much. I mean, continues to give me so much. It's been my whole life, you know, so.
I am going to ask you about your journey to the NHL in just a few minutes, but I want to get Brian's take as well on the spectacle of pretty much an all-white audience giving a standing ovation to a black man in Boston, Massachusetts.
Yeah, I mean, it is a... you know, it's a tough one to, I'm going to broaden the question if I can. Okay.
And please
pick up on something that Laurent said earlier, you know, just to frame it. Okay. And, you know, I'm just going to say it like I feel it. And it's just the truth, right? I mean, the history of the United States is, we're sick. We've got cancer. We've had cancer from the beginning. Okay. And that cancer is racism. It just is. And, you know, yeah. And it's been this dueling, warring dichotomy that's been where the soul of America from day one has been at war with itself. Home of the free, land of the brave, peace, liberty, justice for all. Oh yeah. Slavery and 3/5 a person. Come on. Right. Like, and we've just never dealt with it. Like as a country, the United States has not had the guts to deal with it. And we still haven't dealt with it, right? You're seeing, you know, up until, you know, January 6th, a year ago, we're still doing this stuff. And when the country, you know, the only way to get better is to admit that you're sick and you got a problem and you've got cancer, you've got to solve it, diagnose it and solve it, right? So, you know, for 250 years in this country, you could own people. It's crazy, right? It's insanity. But that's the way it was. For 100 years after that, those people have been legislated against vehemently, and they still are, and we still are in a lot of ways. Just in the last 50, 60 years, okay, my lifetime and our lifetimes, we've had, you know, good progress. But as Laurent said, you know, 3 steps forward, 5 steps back, right? And the whole celebration here of the last month encapsulates it. Last 2 weeks encapsulates it. It's crazy. Willie gets here. Like, just play this out for a second. Willie has his jersey retired on Tuesday. He gets the Congressional Gold Medal. By the way, to Lawrence's point, he became the 12th Boston Bruin to have his jersey retired, and only the third player ever to have his jersey retired for his social justice work, joining Jackie Robinson and Roberto Clemente. I mean, that's like, wow, right? That's amazing stuff.
That's good company.
He tops it off the next day when he gets the Congressional Gold Medal, right, for the highest civilian honor given to an American. And he becomes, when somebody mentioned this to me, I had no idea, and I was blown away. And it shows you the stature of and the work of Willie O'Ree. That Congressional Gold Medal is next to the Order of Canada. So he's the only human being ever to win both awards. The Congressional Gold Medal, George Washington, Martin Luther King. I mean, are you kidding me? Right? Willie has won the same award as those guys. Yep. And then the Order of Canada combined. So that's Monday and Tuesday. Saturday and Sunday, Boko Imama and Jordan Subban are racially harassed on the ice. That's within 5 days, 6 days. The work is not done. It's not even Willie in his Hall of Fame speech said it so well. The work is not done. We've got work to do, right? So if we hopefully can summon the courage, right? And if anyone who disagrees with what I'm saying, respectfully, there were people roaming around in the seat of power in the United States with Confederate flags last January 6th. Enough. Enough. Let's face it, right? And the leadership of people like Willie O'Ree, who have the guts to talk about it and to stare it down and persevere in the face of it, those are the leaders we need.
I'm sorry to say we saw the Confederate flag on the streets of Ottawa at the truckers' protest last week as well.
Crazy.
Okay, so Jay, pick up that story if you would. Obviously, Willie was the first. If you're a person of color today, how comfortable do you feel playing in the National Hockey League?
I mean, I think, you know, I've been out of the game for like off the ice for 5.5 years, but I would have to say that you feel more comfortable now, because I think there has been such a concerted effort, not just by the National Hockey League, but just in society in general, to realize that a sport like hockey should be inclusive, just like society. So, but to Lawrence's point, I believe there is still a lot of work to be done. Because the fact that, as Bryant just said, we had two incidences 5 days after Willie's jersey was retired of racial discrimination, that's very disappointing, very sad. So obviously there is still a lot of work to be done. But I think we're moving in the right direction. I really believe that.
Let's talk about some of that work. Willie has helped get 130,000 kids through a program called Hockey is for Everyone. And Bryant, you were there on day one as that program came into its existence. What's the mission of the program?
Yeah, the mission is inclusivity, right? Everyone deserves a chance. I mean, at the root, the thread that runs through every kid that Willie has talked to, the creation of the program, what continues today, it's really one word. It's opportunity, right? And I want to frame it in an important way, right? I make the argument all the time to friends, the most important sport for kids of color to play, to get an opportunity to play, is hockey. No, what do you mean? What are you talking about? You know, you're not welcome there. You know, I say to them, it's real simple, right? I'm a dad, and if I only can give my kids one thing, if I can only grant them one thing before I'm gone, it's resilience. And skates are a great equalizer. No one's born with skates on. So you get out there, and the first thing that you learn, right, is the first thing that happens is you fall down, you fall on your butt, and the first thing you learn is to get back up. That's a muscle, and that exercise of getting back up no matter what is critical, especially for kids of color, right, to be able to exercise that. And that mastery, that when you get out there, you're 4, 5, 6, 8, 10, however old, you get out there in October, and by April you are, and you can't stand up in October, and by April you're flying around. That ascendancy, that mastery, that transfers to STEM. It transfers to whatever you end up doing in life. That, hey, I can figure stuff out. I can do this no matter what, right? And there, I have yet to find anything. And I dare someone to put something forth that's better than teaching that than hockey. That's why this weekend, my kids have aged out of in-house hockey in Lexington, Massachusetts. I'm the commissioner of my local league for 5 to 10-year-olds because that's where the magic is, right? That's where kids are getting those muscles, getting that skill to be able to persevere, overcome, have fun, not think about anything else, be singular in what they're doing. It's a gift. So that's sorry to be so loquacious about it, but to deny a kid that opportunity or not allow them, that's theft. You're stealing from children. Everyone deserves a chance to play this game. Yeah. The bottom line.
Jay, I know that Major League Baseball put a lot of effort into the history of Jackie Robinson. Because I remember, gosh, this is terrible to say, but I remember 20 and 30 years ago seeing black players in baseball interviewed, Major League Baseball players, and they knew nothing about Jackie Robinson. They do today. Mm-hmm. But my question is, do you think black kids today in Canada, in the United States, do they know who Willie O'Ree is?
I believe there's a lot more kids know that today because of the work of people like Bryant and Lawrence to tell his story. And I think that it's really an amazing thing to think that the amount of motivation you can get from just hearing his story and just what he went through and the fact that, okay, he was black, but he also was blind in his right eye. I mean, it's a great story no matter whether he was black or not. It's just a great story of inspiration that you didn't quit on your dream. And his dream was to play professional hockey in the National Hockey League, and he achieved that. And I think that now, because of social media, because of documentaries, because, you know, we're so much more a tech world, I think his story is out there. And I think a lot more people who never knew who Willie was now know who he is and know what his story is. And I think it's truly inspirational.
Well, I suggested a few minutes ago that we wanted to find out more about both of your journeys to the National Hockey League and how those went, because, let's be frank, one of you started life in Jamaica, one of you started life in Chicago, and then in Sault Ste. Marie. These are not traditionally places that we tend to get black hockey players from or black officials from. So let's tell the story. Jay, you're born in Jamaica. You went to British Columbia at what point?
1967, just after I was born.
And so, what took you there?
My mother is from Canada. She was actually born in Alberta, but then her family settled in British Columbia. And when she and my father were going to start a family, my father said immediately that his kids would grow up in Canada because the opportunities would be better. And, you know, Jamaica, even today, is probably not as many opportunities for a young person to grow up. And he wanted my brother and I to have that. So we lived in a town. My mother still lives there today. It's Hope, British Columbia, which is about 100 miles east of Vancouver. And that's where we ended up settling. My brother and I grew up there.
And how did you get connected to hockey?
No different than any other Canadian kid. I mean, I loved the game. Early on, I had dreams of playing in the National Hockey League. But by the time I was probably 14, 15, I realized my chances of getting there as a player were not going to happen. And so I was determined to find another avenue to get to the NHL. And that's why I started officiating. And I was just obsessed, probably no different than how Willie told the story, that I wanted to be in the National Hockey League. I wanted to be in professional hockey. And officiating was that vehicle that was going to allow me to get there.
Do I assume every step of the way, as a little kid, then into your teenage years, then into your later teenage years, do I assume you're the only black kid on the ice most of the time?
Most of the time, yeah. Yeah. And I mean, you know, when I was every league I've worked in, the British Columbia Hockey League, the Western Hockey League, when I worked in the American League, when I worked in the International League that used to be around, the West Coast Hockey League. Yeah, it was me. So it was not something that I wasn't used to happening. But, you know, it's just, again, I look back at it more now you know, 30 plus years later than I did at that time. At that time, as I said earlier, I was just wanting to be the best official I could be. And I'm a competitive person by nature. So the fact that maybe I had maybe a few more challenges than other guys, that wasn't in my DNA, because that wasn't how my parents raised my brother and I. We were raised to be fighters and to not let other people dictate or direct how your destiny was going to go. And I think, you know, I credit and I have and I will continue to credit my parents for the work ethic and the compassion and the resolve that they gave my brother and I, because no different than I've been fortunate in my hockey career and my brother in his business career. All of that is because of the direction and the guidance and the support that we got as kids.
Nice. Bryant, how does somebody born in Chicago end up in Sault Ste. Marie?
It's fun listening to Jay's story. I mean, it just parallels mine in so many ways, you know. You're so focused, you know, like Jay, you know, who made it to, you know, the pinnacle of his profession and one of the best in the world at what he did. And still, you know, that you're just so focused on that, right? You got to achieve that. You got to climb to that level. You got to get there. You got to stay there, you know, and nothing's going to stand in your way. It's just all you can focus on, right? You do have slights and insults along the way, and you're not seeing people that look like you, and you got to navigate. Right? You got to navigate the locker room. You got to navigate everything. You're kind of doing this calculus constantly of, okay, you got to belong. You got to figure out how to belong. Right. So that's not simple. And it's not without.
Can I ask you about that, Brian? How do you belong when you're the only guy with black skin in a whole locker room full of white guys?
You outperform them. You just do. Right? You just do. You got to work.
You're 100% right, Brian.
You outperform them. You just got to, you earn the respect every minute of every day, and you grind. And, you know, I was a defensive defenseman. I just was like, I'm never, ever going to get beat one-on-one. That's just not going to happen, right? And puck goes in the corner, I'm coming out with it. I mean, it's just, and that's the same way I run my business today, right? I mean, and that those tools stay with you, you know, that drive. I never had a teammate of color, ever. Right. That was like, oh, my God, you know, it bothered me a lot. So, my dad is white. My mom is black. And, you know, as Jay said, you know, you look back on some of the stuff, like the one stat that just blows my mind. I mean, this just like I can't wrap my head around it. But I was born in 65. My parents got married in 69. OK, I was my dad adopted me. But you know, my mom had me in Chicago, met my dad, and then we moved up to Sault Ste. Marie. I look back at the history, and this is, again, where I'm a nut about the history and people doing the work and understanding the context that has led us to today. It was illegal. This is crazy what I'm going to say. It was illegal for my parents to marry in 32 states in 1969. Think about that. That's bonkers, right, to think about. But that was the case. And the really crazy thing is the last of those laws, those interracial marriage laws, it went off the books in 2000. Like, what?
That's right? That long ago.
It's not that long ago. It's a minute ago, right? And it was almost defeated in an election in Alabama. That's the truth, right? So this whole, oh, that was a long time ago. I was like, come on, guys, let's be serious. This stuff is still going on. It's just uneven, and it's morphed, right? It's metastasized. Again, racism is cancer. So, you know, so you just had to figure it out. You had to navigate. You had to be better than the next person. And, you know, and you look back and you realize a lot of things. You know, Jay has been a whole bunch of firsts. He blazed that trail, right, for other kids to follow. I've been a whole bunch of firsts. I'm tired of being a first. We don't want to be first anymore. Right. But one of the first right place, right time that I found myself in, I went to West Point. I went to the military academy at West Point, and I was the first black class president at West Point in 1984. And I really realized, I thought about it, you know, post George Floyd, social awakening, kind of like stepping back and looking at your path. I lived in General Lee Barracks at West Point. That bothers me.
Named after Robert E. Lee, the Confederate general.
A guy who risked his life and sent men to die to protect the institution of slavery. Come on, right? 4,000 monuments and roads and bridges and roads named after him all over the United States to this day. Let's heal, right? We've got this open wound that we won't address and we won't heal. So, you know, it was a journey that wasn't without consequence, that wasn't without challenge, but one that had to be navigated. I'm so glad that I had the opportunity to navigate it. And same thing, in parallel with Jay, it was my parents. And it was just an incredible network of people around me who supported me, who still support me to this day, who lift me up and lifted me up and just set me on my way so that I could have these opportunities. And I feel the obligation and the weight, you know, to figure stuff out no matter what. I mean, when I sat down with Laurence on that stoop and we were talking about it, I'd never made a movie. I didn't know how to make a movie, but I figured it out. And I figured it out really quickly because that's what Jay shares and I have had to do, you know, no matter what. You have to figure it out. You're not like, well, you know, maybe I'll try this or... No, I'll use a baseball analogy. We were not born on third base. We weren't in the stadium. We had to fight our way in the stadium, get through everything, and then figure out our way to get home. And we did. And that journey should be, when people talk about equity, that's what I'm talking about. Everyone should start in the same place. Everyone should have the same opportunities. And by the way, along the way, if say Jay blew like a major call, and I'm sure it maybe happened once or twice in his life, not very often. I watched him a lot, but you know, and it didn't happen very often because he knew that if it happened, he may not get another shot, right? Especially at the highest level. And I know, as you know, I'm an entrepreneur. I build companies at the intersection of sports, media, and technology. I'm going to ask you a question, both of you. What percentage do you think of invested capital, money to work with, the powder you need, the funds you need to build, what percentage goes to Black entrepreneurs in North America?
Wouldn't have a clue.
I'd be a shot in the dark. I would say less than 5%.
1%.
1%.
Wow.
Think about that. People to say there's no systemic racism in this country?
Yeah.
Stop it. Cut it out. You know? Walk my path. 1%. You're out there trying to build a business and you know that you've got to fight to find, it's hard enough. You got to fight, and it's not, oh, woe is me. I found the money and I'm figuring it out no matter what, right? Because I'm coming out of the corner with the puck.
So, well, and Brian, you know this, and I mean, I've always said this, like, I think when our parents were going and navigating challenges and racism, people were very demonstrative and people were very overt with their comments. Now, people know that that's not socially acceptable, but right. They still think those things, but they say them quietly or they say them behind somebody's back.
Right.
And that's, but it's almost, honestly, I'd rather have somebody say it right to my face. And obviously it's tragic and it's terrible that both your parents, my parents went through it, but I'd rather have somebody just be upfront instead of grinning at me and making me feel like, oh, this person really has respect for me. But at the end of the day, as soon as I leave the room or as soon as they're alone with other people, it's just as bad as it was in the late 50s, early 60s.
Jay, can I ask you about that? Anytime you made a call that a player didn't like at any point in your career, did anybody drop the N-word on you if they didn't like the call?
You know what? Only once in professional hockey in the NHL, but it happened a lot in junior. And it happened with coaches, it happened with players, happened with parents. I mean, it was just an easy thing, you know, it was just an easy thing for people to do. I will say, save and except for one instance in the NHL, I never experienced that directly to my face. Now, as I just stated, I'm sure there was things said behind my back and, you know, coach A or player B maybe had their own opinion. But fortunately, in my career, I never had to deal with that at the NHL level.
Have you ever identified who the player was who said it to you in the NHL?
Oh, yeah.
You want to tell us tonight?
I don't think that's necessary.
Okay. Can you tell me how you handled the moment?
I handled it the way I would with anything. I handled it the way I learned when I was coming out through junior hockey, was to treat disrespect with respect. And although I addressed it directly, I was not trying to be confrontational, because that's A, that's not my nature. B, that's not the job that I did, you know, and my job, and any official who's in the NHL or any sport, is upholding the integrity of the game. And nobody is bigger than the game. Wayne Gretzky left the game went on. You know, Gordie Howe left the game goes on. So nobody is bigger than the game. I'm not going to let someone who made that kind of remark to me think that they are bigger than the game. The game is bigger than everybody.
Absolutely. Did you ever try to reach out to that person after the fact to try to maybe have a teachable moment with them?
No, because in my opinion, the type of person that he is or was at that time, I don't know if it would have made any difference. And I wasn't going to waste my time, because the fact of what he said to me and things that he has said to other people during his playing career, it was definitely a pattern. And it was definitely, I think, how he has lived his life. But you know what? Now that he's out of hockey, maybe he has a different perspective. And I would hope that that would be the case. But I didn't feel it was my job or my responsibility to teach him. But you know what? Maybe I should have, because this happened. The person I am today at age 55, absolutely, I would have that conversation. But the person I was when it happened in the NHL, or how I conducted myself in my career, that wasn't something that I wanted to undertake at the time.
So if I could add to that, Steve.
Please, Brian.
We're such a fork in the road in the social, you know, social, I just call it the social awakening window in this country, right? George Floyd was such a seminal moment. And for reasons that are different than people think, you know, we watched this poor man die. We watched the murder. Like, we all watched it, right? Which was just jarring and hard and crazy. But that's not the parable. That's not the takeaway. Okay, as awful as that was. So we watched it. It was visceral. It was, you know, it was irrefutable. We saw it, right? But not only did we see it, we heard it. White, black, old, young. During the trial, I don't know if you watched it, those people saying, stop it, get off, I'm doing, you know, they were people, that these people, the witnesses, were America, right? And they were saying, get off him, right? But at the heart of it, the real heart of that, were the four cops. Those four cops are literally the soul of America, right? And the test that each one of us faces every single day. At any juncture, those four cops could have turned to Derek Chauvin and said, "Hey, you know, he's up." Just that, or tapped him on the shoulder. I got him. They did nothing. Right. So the choice, and as Jay said, it's not about the overt inward calling, or, you know, that those guys, you know, what are you going to do? That's hard, right? When they're there, it's shape shifts. It's cancer metastasizes. It comes in many forms, right? There's 100 known versions of cancer known to man. And you've got to be, you know, an incredible doctor to know them all. So when that pertains to race, every American, you're one of the four cops. Are you going to do something? And it's binary. It's a choice. Are you going to do something or not? That's racism. Are you going to do something or not? And if you don't do anything, I'm sorry, but you are not helping. You are part of the problem, right? So rather than just sitting here and pointing, I brought a prop. Rather than just pointing out the problems today, I've read hundreds of books on this. I mean, you can see I'm passionate about it. I'm burst on it. But really, I'm burst on it in the last, like, since I made the movie. Like, Jay, what, just head down, go. And I'm just, all of these things, I step back and I'm just reading and I'm learning. And I'm just like, oh my God, I've had my head in the sand. I haven't really dialed into this and done the work. A lot of people are talking about doing the work. I found one book and I'm going to show it to you. If you want to do something, if you don't want to be one of the four cops, this book is 200 pages.
Take The Racial Healing Handbook by whom?
It's by a woman named Annalise Singh. Okay, she's from Georgia. She's an educator. It's like a high school or college workbook. And I'm telling you, you're white, black, doesn't matter. You take a few hours and you look through this book, you will be a better person. It asks you questions like that really make you introspective and go, whoa, I never really thought about that. What would you do to change how you were taught about race as a child?
Okay, I take your point, Brian, but I do want to ask you, when you were playing varsity soccer or varsity hockey, when you were at college in Massachusetts, how did you handle those moments where somebody on the pitch or somebody on the ice dropped the N-word on you?
Didn't have a lot of them. Didn't have a lot of them. But you remember, I was playing in the 70s, 80s, and it just, you know, it changed. The civil rights movement, you didn't call a white, one of the worst things that can happen to a white person in this country is that they're called a racist. And be like, oh my God, that's terrible. Oh my, I'm not, right? It's very defensive. So the people learned. They learned to dial that down. You don't say it overt. It's not polite. It's not in polite company. So that became a bar that people, or a line that people didn't cross, better said, right? So it happened maybe a handful of times, if that, you know, and so it was kind of like, okay, he's an idiot, whatever. You drive on. You can't get consumed with it. It'll eat you alive, right? So I didn't have to deal with that. I'm more, you know, focused on the kind of the, you know, I'm a dad and I'm worried. You worry about your kids. You worry, there's this dual racial anxiety. I worry every time, and my wife and I worry every time my kids leave my driveway. You go gulp, okay, you know, get back alive, you know, get back safe and, you know, here, right? That's one. But the other racial anxiety that I'm dialing into, and I understand it better now, is I got, after George Floyd, I got 30, 40, 50 calls from my white friends, CEOs, CMOs, big jobs. And they said, hey, you know what, McBride, we sent out our We Love Black People letter. What do I do now? Right? Because they didn't want to get canceled. They didn't want to get, you know, so there's this dual racial anxiety. We're just not taught how to deal with it in this country. And we need to focus on it or we'll never heal.
Yeah. Gotcha.
Well, and as I like to always say too, and that's very well said, Brian, but, you know, intolerance or prejudice or racism, those aren't a genetic trait you're born with.
Exactly.
You're taught to think that way, and you're taught to make those statements. And that is the bigger, in my opinion, and in my experience, that is the bigger issue at hand, is where you have somebody who's Brian or my age or younger, and they're raising children. And if they're teaching their children that being prejudiced or being, you know, discriminatory is acceptable, that's the bigger part of the problem.
100%.
Because we're in 2022, we're not in 1958. So that's the bigger part of the problem, in my opinion.
And people aren't going to stand for it anymore. That's the other thing. They're like, enough. This false construct, and I'm going to say it like it is. It is a false construct. Race is a false construct. Mm-hmm. It's invented. Right? Oh, there's some medical thing, or there's some biological or physical.
Nope.
It's bullshit. Like, stop it, right? Yep. So we got to wrap our heads around that and come to terms with it.
Yep.
I'd like, Jay, while we have you here, I want to just change course a little bit.
Yeah.
Because I've never talked to anybody before in my life who has officiated in 7 Stanley Cup series. So I want to take advantage of this opportunity to ask you, all these years later, what stays with you? What do you remember most about having the really extraordinary opportunity to be an official in so many Stanley Cup finals?
No, and that's a great question. It's an easy answer for me, because in 2011, I worked Boston and Vancouver. And being from Hope, which is 100 miles east of Vancouver, I ended up working Game 7 in that series. And my family was able to come to the game, my daughter, my mother, my brother, and my sister-in-law, and I was able to share that experience. And, you know, it's easy to say, well, what was your favorite game? What was this? That is an easy answer for me, that Game 7 in 2011, Vancouver, Boston, in Vancouver, that was just a special moment that I will never, ever forget. And the fact that Vancouver lost and they burned the city down. So.
But thankfully, not because of any call you made.
No. They were just mad that because I think after Vancouver had won Game 6, won Game 5, they thought that for sure they were going to, you know, win the series, and Boston was just a better prepared team, and they ended up winning in Vancouver. So
yeah. Now, are you able to fess up all these years later that you probably were a little extra nervous that night because you had family in the building?
You know, somebody asked me this the other day, and I think, honestly speaking, I was nervous every game because, to Brian's point, I wanted to be so good every game all the time that I put so much pressure on myself. But that was just because I wanted to succeed and because I was competitive. But having that being game seven in Vancouver with my family, Stanley Cup final, yeah, there was definitely some nerves there. But I still was able to, as my father would say, enjoy the journey. And yeah, I did enjoy the journey. The fact, again, that I could share this with my family and the fact that I'd been there before, I think it was a little easier for me to navigate it. It wasn't my first time in the Stanley Cup Finals. So I was able to enjoy that experience. And again, to just share it with your family is just, there's nothing greater.
And when you met up with them after the game, seeing them for the first time, tell us what happened.
Well, honestly, we didn't leave the rink until probably 2.5 hours after the game because of all the craziness that was happening out on the streets of Vancouver, like police cars being vandalized and people setting fires and throwing rocks through windows. So our security actually said to us, the safest place for you guys right now is to just stay in the locker room. So we ended up staying there. My family was able to get back to the hotel safely, but I just sat there with my teammates and we just, you know, kind of decompressed and watched some of the stuff that was going on the streets on television. And it was a very, interesting way to end a season or end a Stanley Cup final for sure.
Brian, for you, what was the most memorable moment on skates in your career?
Before I answer that question, I should say too, that, you know, looking back, you know, I haven't worked the league for a long time, but and I'm not just saying this because Jay's a friend and he's here, the best people in the hockey business, as a former league executive, just as bar none, the best people in hockey were the referees and the linesmen. They're just the best guys.
Why do you say that?
They're just selfless. They were so selfless. They were approachable, always prepared, professional, work hurt. I mean, they're unbelievable guys. I mean,
it's awfully nice of you to say that, Brian.
It was the truth looking back on it, and I have no agenda. They were just the best guys, you know, that would just do, you know. I remember I was in Finland in a preseason tournament, and Carey Fraser was working the game, and he was, he was missing one of his kids' first day of kindergarten. And I said, you know, and this was early in the cell phone world, Nokia phones. I said, you know, and I asked, you know, I got his home number, and I let him talk to his son or daughter, I can't remember, but talk to his kindergartner as they were going to school, right? To this day, I see Carey Fraser, and he gives me a big hug, and he's just like, dude, what you did, and you know, I mean, just stuff like that.
That's awesome.
That's just who they are. I mean, they just were so, they're the guys who did the work. You know, that's just the bottom line, and integrity for the game, the integrity of the game. And Faye Vincent, the former commissioner of baseball, is a mentor and investor in what I do and friend. And his dad was a NFL linesman, or an NFL referee. And he held that same, you know, the highest standard of and what anyone can do is to officiate and make sure that things are square and done well. And somebody once made a joke about Gaylord Perry throwing spitballs in front of Faye, and he goes, that's not funny.
Yeah.
That's who he was, but it was imbued inside of him, you know, so it was pretty cool.
Yeah, it's interesting, but the job of both teams is to win, but the job of the official is justice. It's to make sure things are fair.
You know, at the end of the day, it's fair and safe. I mean,
that's higher calling. This guy's had a higher calling.
That's our motto.
Okay, but Bryant, I'm not going to let you get away without giving us a memory of yours from your time playing hockey.
Yeah.
You got something
you still stays with you? Yeah, my favorite moment was my last game. We won. I played at Trinity College in Hartford, and we won our championship that final game. I knew it was my last competitive game, and, played our hearts out, and it was the third of three championships that we won. We ran the table on the 3 years after I transferred from West Point, and I have not gone. This is crazy. You know, I graduated 30 plus years ago. This is a wild stat. I have not gone 1 month in those 30 years without talking to one of my teammates from that team.
Isn't that great? What is the trophy that you win for being the champion?
It was the NESCAC, New England Small College Athletic Conference, Division III. But it didn't matter. It felt like the Stanley Cup. It was awesome.
And what number did you wear?
I was number 4. I was a defensive defenseman, as my coach John Dunham used to say. I couldn't put it in the ocean if I was standing on a beach.
But what do you think I quit playing for?
But nobody got around me, so you know.
Did you wear number 4 for Bobby?
No, not for Bobby. Nope. I'm sorry, but no.
Okay. How come you wore number 4?
It was, you know, same kind of thing. It was given to me. It was a low number, and you know, I was 8 growing up, and I did wear number 6 when I was playing in Sault Ste. Marie for the Sioux Legion, because that's what Ronnie Francis wore 2 years before me. And Ronnie was just the gold standard, man. That guy, man. And you know how as a kid, I was 2 years behind him always. So I'd get called up, and I had the best seat in the arena when I played against Ronnie Francis. I'll never forget it. He was like 13 or 14 years old, and he just crazy skills, I mean, like ridiculous hands, even at that age, but he was tiny. He was really a small guy. And over one summer, he grew 6 inches. He just all of a sudden shot up, right? When he was a teenager, and he lost. And not a lot of kids become gangly and uncoordinated. He was still like lights out. He just did not lose a beat, and he was bigger and faster, and you know, he just smooth. So yeah, that was interesting watching. You know, he came out. We didn't know who he was, and we figured, oh my God, that's Francis, and he's big now. Oh great.
They didn't call him Ronnie Franchise for nothing.
Real deal, and the best guy in the world.
I do want to introduce another voice to our conversation, but before I do, Jay, I've got to find out what 57 was your number. Yes.
Yes.
For any reason in particular?
So actually, in my officiating career, I wore 57 as a linesman. I wore 40 when I first started refereeing, when I went back to referee in 2010. And then I ended up wearing 22 when I was full-time. The 136 games that I worked as a full-time NHL referee, I wore 22. So I didn't pick. I picked 57. 22 and 40 were given to me. But I think it was kind of special that 22 was Willie's number, and the fact that I ended up wearing that when I refereed was pretty good.
That is very special. And why did you pick 57?
You know what? No, I think I just liked the way it looked physically, like just the fact that the top of the 5 and the top of the 7. I like cars, so maybe it was like a 57 Chevy. It was no real special reason why I picked it.
Well, we've been talking all night long about a guy who played for the Boston Bruins 64 years ago and who made history. And I'd like to introduce another person to our conversation right now who also played for the Boston Bruins, this time in the early 1990s. And he too was a black man, is a black man. Darren Banks, come on in here and join our conversation. And we're so grateful you could make some time for us tonight, Darren. Where are you coming to us from?
At my house in Las Vegas.
You're in Las Vegas, Nevada. That's not a bad place to be right now.
We're at 74 degrees out today, yes.
Oh, stop it. Please, stop it. You're breaking my heart here. Okay, Darren, I want to start by, first of all, you know these other two guys, Bryant and Jay.
Yes, I do.
Good to see you, Darren.
I wanted to ask you, for starters, are you the second black player for the Boston Bruins in their history?
I don't think so. I think Graham Townsend had played maybe a couple of years before me. And
Ray Neufeld?
Graham played before me there, maybe a couple of years before I got there.
Ray Neufeld maybe too.
Yeah. Oh, Ray Neufeld too. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you tell me what it was like, though, to step on the ice for the Boston Bruins, knowing that Willie O'Ree essentially wore that same uniform you did?
Oh, it was exciting. I mean, be honest with you, when you first put the NHL jersey on, it doesn't matter what team you're on. You're just happy that you finally made it there. And my first game, you know, I mean, I played in Calgary first, but I didn't play any NHL games, like real games, just exhibition games. But when I played that first real game after all the exhibition games I played in Boston, I was just ecstatic. And that building was unbelievable.
Did you enjoy your time in the NHL?
Yeah, maybe too much.
Now, what does that mean?
Yeah, I enjoyed myself on and off the ice.
Okay, I think we understand what that means. How welcoming an environment, now this is in the early 1990s that you played for the Bruins. How welcoming an environment for a black player was it in the NHL in those days?
You know what, in Boston, you know, most people thought it'd be real racist there for me, but it wasn't, I think, because I played for them. But when you're in other cities, you hear all kinds of stuff. I mean, you just kind of plug it out. And I learned at a really young age that if I wanted to succeed anyway, I just had to play my game and not worry about all those other things. And because the role I played, if players had things to say, I had no problems taking liberties on you. And people not knowing what had happened sometimes, but they watched their tone around me.
Did you have the N-word used against you during your career at any point?
A few times, and I might have went after a few guys. I mean, it would happen, but again, I played a rough style of hockey that I could, you know, necessarily take an easy body check. You might get an extra cross check with it. So I got away with it sometimes, but sometimes I was mad at a guy. But again, I had to block a lot of that out if you want to play the game properly.
Mm-hmm. Now, you played more than a dozen years of pro hockey at various levels. Did you ever have Jay Scherz do one of your games?
I don't know. I mean, referees weren't my thing.
The fact that you don't remember, that's probably a good thing.
That's right.
I was usually yelling at him. And back then, you could say stuff to a referee that I don't think you can say to a ref now. But he might have done one of my games as possible. I mean, look at – I mean, you see in pictures, I'm guys ripping me apart. It was just – it didn't – I wouldn't have known what referee he was unless he ref me every single game. And then I knew – you know, how he was going to call me or what he was going to let me get away with.
Jay, do you have any recollection of doing a game that Darren was in?
You know what? I remember Darren, his name, but I don't know if we were ever on the ice together. We probably were, but I think like I was expressing before, after, you know, 1,500 plus games, sometimes a few of them run together. So, you know, an actual memory, I don't know if it's there.
Okay. Darren, I wonder if there were moments in your career, obviously when you played in the NHL or frankly at any level, you would have been one of the very few black players on the ice at any particular time. And I wonder if there are those moments when you're on the ice and maybe it's a commercial break or something like that, and maybe there's a fella on the other team who's black as well. Do you take the time to acknowledge each other because of the uniqueness of that circumstance?
Yeah, and that usually happened in warm-up. You know, back then you kind of had a little bit of more of a conversation at the red line where I liked to skate back and forth. And that was usually my time to say hi to a guy. And a lot of times I didn't know who he was. You know, from where I grew up in Windsor, there wasn't any black hockey players at all besides my little brother. So to see a guy from Toronto or Nova Scotia or wherever he was from, and, you know, it was unique to know each other. And we kind of got to know each other, but not really well. And unless you played on the same team together.
Hmm. Did you know much about Willie O'Ree before you laced up in the NHL?
Before I laced up, it happened. He lived in San Diego at the time. And I was in the I at the beginning of my career. And that's when I first met him. I think I met him in 1990 or 91. I met him in San Diego. And I still didn't really know much about him. But then, you know, I would hear the stories about him, and I'd know, oh, he played in Boston. And I'd heard he was the first black hockey player, but I didn't know much about him. And I wasn't really a history buff when it came to hockey. People asked me, who's your favorite team? I didn't have a favorite team. I only liked certain players. So I didn't know about a lot of guys. And I learned as I kind of kept playing, I learned about other people.
Do you think black players in the NHL, or for that matter, at any level of hockey these days, do they know more about Willie and do they understand the contribution he made to hockey?
I think they do now because they're getting education about it and they're learning about it. And they're learning about myself and other guys that played in the league where a lot of guys didn't know, or they got an opportunity to see, you know, guys in the 90s or I wouldn't say the young kids seen them in the 80s, but 90s and 2000s, they got to see and hear about other players that played. And, you know, maybe that made some kids want to play hockey or strive to be the next black kid playing in the NHL.
Hmm. I want to ask each of you one last question here. And that is, and again, we've made the comparison to baseball a few times tonight. I know when I was a kid, the percentage of black Major League Baseball players was significantly higher than it is today. The number of black baseball players in the majors today is decreasing. And obviously in the NHL, it's increasing. And Darren, why don't you start us off here? Do you have a vision of the future of the National Hockey League where black players can feel just the same as white players on the ice? Do you see that happening in our lifetime?
It's going to take some time still. I mean, until you've got at least five or six black guys on your team, on every team, it's not really going to get like that. And then I think you need a black NHL coach for that to even happen.
Definitely.
Who could be the first black NHL coach?
Oh, my God. He's a buddy of mine. He's coaching in Cincinnati right now in the American League.
Paul Is Girard. That
Sorry, what was the name?
Paul Girard.
No, oh, Paul, I forgot about him. I mean, he's been an assistant, but no. Oh, God, I just sent him a message a couple days ago. Payne. I can't remember his first name.
Okay. Is that a job you'd ever entertain doing someday?
Not me. I'm done with it. I like doing alumni stuff. That's all I want to do. I don't – that travel and all that, I'm done with that. I live in Vegas, and I love it here.
Okay, I get you. Jay, how about you? Do you see in our lifetime a situation happening whereby black players, white players, everybody is essentially treated the same when they lace up the blades?
Well, I mean, I think, and again, I've been out for 5.5 years. I think it's getting to that point amongst players in the league now where there is that. Certainly at the NHL level, unfortunately, like we talked about earlier in the show, you know, some stuff is still happening at the minor league level, which is unfortunate. But I think that there's enough respect that you just want, if you make it to the NHL, whether you're a player, a coach, a trainer, an official, like there's some respect because you've had to put the work in and you've had to pay your dues in terms of getting there. It's not an easy road. Darren knows that, and I certainly know that. And so I think the cool thing now is that, and what I'd love to see, I would love to see an all-black officiating crew one day in the NHL. And I don't know if that's going to happen in my lifetime, but that to me would be really cool.
I just as you said that, it reminded me of that time. Gosh, I don't know how many years ago this was. It was probably more than 40 years ago when the Pittsburgh Pirates went out on the field with 9 black players. Yeah. And it wasn't on purpose. It just happened.
No. Yeah, that because they were good.
Yeah, they started an all-black lineup, and yeah, because they were the best. Yeah. Bryant, all right, your vision of the NHL going forward looks like what?
It 100% will happen. I'm going to go out there on the limb. I'm sure of it. I know it. When I started at the National Hockey League, there were 3 players of color in the league. There's now 40. Okay, but it took you know 25 years. That's way too long, right? Yeah. So about a year ago, right after George Floyd, I got together with Bernice Carnegie. You'll remember that name. You know, that's Herb Carnegie's daughter.
Because we remember Herb exactly.
Yeah, and we named this initiative that we started the Carnegie Initiative for just that reason. Right. Herb tried out. Herb was one of the best players in the world in the 1940s. You know, I asked Jean Beliveau, you know, who the 5 best players were he ever played with. And I'm thinking he's going to rattle off all those, you know, those 10 Stanley Cup winning teams. Herb Carnegie was on that list. Mm-hmm. You go, whoa, what? You know, and he said, oh, yeah, he was amazing. He taught me how to play. I was like, oh, my God, really? So, you know, Mr. Beliveau, I called him Mr. Beliveau. And Herb, you know, he tried out for the Leafs and Conn Smythe famously told him that, you know, I'd pay anyone $10,000 to paint you white. Never played a game in the league. Herb told me that story in his 80s and cried his eyes out. I never forgot it. And it just gave me fire. It gave me fuel to do what I do today. So, you know, what Herb did in response to that comment in 19, this is wild because I just put these pieces together in the last year. Herb put in 1955, the exact same week that Rosa Parks, December 1955, Herb started the Future Aces Hockey School, where he brought white and black and indigenous kids together to play together. That's what he did in response to that slight that he had from Conn Smythe. And he did that for the next 6 decades. He did that work, right? So, you know, all of us on this screen, we're standing on the shoulders of giants, Herb, Willie, the Maritime Leagues, the colored hockey leagues, as they were called in the 1870s, 80s, and 90s, right? So this is 150 years of history here, right? That people just don't realize that history is critically important to the growth of the game. The Maritimes, they started, you know, they created the butterfly. Some people say they created the slap shot, right? Way back then, right? These are escaped slaves, resettled, who played softball in the summer in church leagues and then played hockey in the winter, right? The history is incredible. So, you know, so Bernice and I started this initiative. Jay was nice enough to come. We put 200 people in a room in the middle of the pandemic, and we said, with intent and purpose, over the next 10 years, as hockey's declining in Canada, right? Total population of hockey players is declining, right? Immigrant kids coming out of the woodwork who want to play. How do we, that 10, 11, 12X from three players to 40 that I mentioned, how do we do that in 10 years? That's what we're going to do. That's what we are doing. We're going to have another summit, the Carnegie Initiative Summit, next year in Toronto, hopefully pandemic-free. And we are working. There is, mark my words, there is a movement happening right now in this country. Black, brown, all marginalized people, women who want to play this game, and they want that opportunity that we talked about earlier. This is happening. And because, you know, the tipping point, the switch flips in 2044. The majority of people in North America will be visible minorities.
Yep.
That's what's going on. So if the NHL doesn't, and hockey in general, doesn't, you know, get attuned to that, we're going to be NASCAR. I'm sorry, NASCAR fans, but that's not a great place to be, right? You know, if your sport's not diverse. So I will say unequivocally, 100%, this game is going to, the game and the change in this game is about to accelerate in a big, big way. Mark my words.
You know what? On that hopeful note, let me thank all three of you for joining us tonight on Hockey Time Machine. And our little tradition at this point, I promised Darren he'd only have to stick with us for 15 minutes, and I know we're running right up against that 15. But our little tradition at this point is to get Glenn and Paul and Laura to come on and join us for a few minutes and thank you three for being so giving of your time. And particularly in Black History Month, shining a light on a subject that we all need to know so much more about. So thank you so much for doing so. And Glenn, why don't you unmute and start us off here?
Well, I had a couple of questions for Darren. By the way, Jason Payne is the head coach of the Cincinnati Cyclones of the ECHL. But I'd like to ask Darren, what is going on here?
That's awesome.
I was just, we were having fun in London, England.
who are those guys?
That's Greg Smythe, who passed away. And, oh, God, I forget the other guy's name. He played in Edmonton. I can't remember his name.
Darren, you're having a tough time with names tonight.
Well, I've been punched in the head a lot.
Well, you guys look like the Hanson brothers to me.
Yeah, we were having fun in London, England. That was like one of my last years before I retired.
That's great.
So the other question
he played in Edmonton.
This is how Darren normally looks. He's a sharp dressed man.
Yes, he is.
In this next photo, I need to ask, what is going on here, Darren?
Awesome.
What exactly is going on here?
Well, this is EDC. This is where in Las Vegas, the D, Circa, Golden Gate, our three casinos, we like to go out and have a good time.
Now that's an outfit.
It looks like a good time is being had.
Oh, it was freezing that day.
Glenn, you are mischievous.
Well, so let me turn a little more serious because our guest raised some really important points, so important that I actually got out my soapbox.
Guilty. You
know, in the overdue recognition of Willie O'Ree, Herb Carnegie's name was mentioned, and we shouldn't forget the other Black pioneers, Boomer Harding and Alton White and Bill Riley and Val James and Mike Marson. And if you will indulge me, I want to read to you a few quotes. Mike Marson entered the NHL 15 years after Willie O'Ree started. And there was quite a gap there between when Willie played his last NHL game and Mike Marson played his first. By the way, Bryant, you said Milt Schmidt never swore. Now, that may be true in Boston, but when he was the coach and general manager with the Capitals, I wonder, he might have had a few swear words.
You lose that many games, you're going to swear.
But the first black teammates in NHL history were Mike Morrison and Bill Riley for the Capitals in 1974, which is great. But what was not so great is what Morrison went through. So if you'll indulge me, this is a Mike Morrison quote. They're asking the coaching staff at a hotel, who is this kid? Is he with you? Well, we don't have people like him staying at our hotel. And he said, the hate mail was so cowardly. We're going off on a 10-day road trip and you have a wife at home. You have to be wondering if they're safe. I used to have a Jaguar and I had people loosen the lug nuts. And on the ice, you're not just playing to win. You have to watch your back. You've got to know to get your head up because so-and-so is going to be running you. Someone else is trash talking you. Teammates even pretended not to know him when he boarded planes. A death threat was once phoned into the Philadelphia Spectrum. And his teammate Bill Riley said this, we figured if we said anything, we would be deemed troublemakers. And he told the story, Bill Riley did, about a bus driver, a team bus driver dropping the N-word, and the coach of the Capitals at that time laughing. And Bill Riley said nothing was said about it, nothing was done about it. That's 74. As your guests have pointed out very correctly and very importantly, it's 2022 and we have Boko Imama and Mr. Subban, Jordan Subban, both experience hatred, and it is incumbent on all of us to stay vigilant and not act like, well, we've honored Willie O'Ree, so we've put away that little racism unpleasantness. Now let's figure out what to do about the red line. Okay, Glenn, I'm off my soapbox.
Glenn, if I may, I'm going to break some news for you guys tonight, okay? In response to what happened to Boko and to Jordan Subban, a week from today in Central Park at Woolman Rink, with Turner Sports and the NHL, the Carnegie Initiative, the Women's League, the Premier Hockey Federation, we are flying in Boko and Jordan. What we're doing? How do you respond to black hate with black excellence and black joy? What we're doing is we are showcasing the five best moments. You'll see it announced next week in hockey history. Devontae Smith-Pelly's goal, Anson Carter's overtime winner in 2003, Akil Thomas's goal against the Russians, right? One of Angela James's goals. The five best plays in black hockey history, and the whole world's going to vote on them in the next 2 weeks. As well as we're going to ask people to submit their own best plays, their own messages, black, white, doesn't matter, right? And the winner, as chosen by Boko and Jordan and Willie and Anson Carter, we're going to fly them to New York to skate with the guys at Woolman Rink and to go to a Rangers and a Devils game. That's how we respond.
Wonderful. Wonderful.
Well, Morrison also said in 74, I don't want to be known as a black hockey player. I just want to be known as a hockey player. And that's the day that I hope we all get to, when these things are so usual that we don't even raise. Oh, and let me mention one other thing. Where I'm from in Seattle, on the 17th, Everett Fitzhugh and JT Brown are going to be the broadcast team for a Seattle Kraken game at Winnipeg. Why does that matter? Because as far as I know, they'll be the first black announcing team in the history of the National Hockey League. So some good things are happening, Bryant.
Absolutely. Good. Keep an eye out for a young guy named Jason Ross at the Chicago Blackhawks. Huge talent. 22 years old, black guy, 23. He just has taken...
I saw his story.
He's awesome. Awesome kid.
Paul, come on in here and give us your last words.
Yeah, I want to talk about Mike Marcin. Great guy. Had a long talk with him, and the things he was telling me were pretty frightening. And Mike called me and he says he wanted to write a book about his experiences. So I said, I'll help you. We'll go to some publishers, and we did. But then Mike sort of backed out. And I don't know, maybe he was nervous about it, but he's got a story to tell, and he really should. So if you guys know him, maybe you can encourage him, because we're here to help, you know. And for Alton White, well, they're going to be honoring him as a WHA 50th anniversary reunion. And so that's kind of nice as well. So I hope to meet him. I haven't met Alton. I've met Laura, and I are friends with Val James, another great guy. And, you know, we just laugh all the time when we're all together. So, you know, just, you know, glad you guys came on tonight. You guys were fantastic. And,
truly.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you. Laura, you always get the last word.
All right. Thanks so much for joining us, everyone. We really appreciate you coming on tonight and spending your time with us and educating us and talking hockey history. And everyone who enjoyed this program, could you do me a favor and press the button down below that says like? There's also a little button that says subscribe. So every time we go live, it'll let you know, and press the little button that has the bell on it as well. So it'll send you little messages to say, hey, we're on live. Come watch Hockey Time Machine. So Paul, anything else from you? Otherwise, we are gone for the night.
Oh, no. Laura always gets the last word. Not Paul. Laura does.
Paul's done.
Darren, Jay, Bryant, thank you so much. This was extraordinary tonight. We're
thank
so grateful.
Guys. Thanks so much, guys.